Great. Welcome to our session. I'm going to wait a minute or two to see who else logs in before we begin. So just hold on to your hats for a moment. Okay, welcome to our participants today. I'm Charles McClintock. I'm with Fielding and the director of Fielding's Institute for Social Innovation. Some of you, I hope, have heard of that. But you are going to hear importantly about it today from one of our ISI fellows, Dr. Anita Chambers. Anita is, I think, has been one of our longest standing ISI fellows, and we have been extremely proud to have her as a fellow, and I think you will be equally proud when you see the results of her work today. A few items on logistics. We are recording this session, and the recording will be available, I think, within an hour or two after the completion of the session on the website. We have you all muted right now, but you can, of course, put material in the chat, and after Anita's presentation, when she takes questions, we'll unmute people. But if you do have a comment or a question, please feel free to put it into the chat. And I think with that, we are probably ready to go. Let me just check one other thing. Yeah, here we go. So Anita, I don't have a formal introduction for you. Maybe you can do a little bio background if you'd like to, but I just want to say that I find the work that you have done to be just stunning, and probably some of the most important work that I've ever seen in my 20 years at Fielding, not just of graduates, but of anyone, faculty, staff, anyone. The impact of what you do and the innovativeness of what you do is just stunning. So, with that, let me turn it over to you, Anita, and we welcome you in this important keynote presentation.
Thank you, Charles. I really appreciate that. That means a lot. I am going to share my screen. Here we go. And we will get started. All right, wonderful. Hopefully everyone can see my screen. Charles, can you confirm you can see it? Excellent. All right. My name is Anita Chambers. You're going to get a little bit about me in just a second, but first I would like to say thank you to Fielding. Thank you for Charles for asking me to do this presentation. I think people who hear me speak about what I do always comment that they can feel the passion. So I always love talking about what I do and being of service to others. So thank you for giving me that opportunity. So welcome. Welcome to the session. I am Anita Chambers. And as Charles said, I am actually very, very proud to be a founding fellow. So I graduated from the HOD program in 2009 and was one of the first two fellows that took up the position in 2009, and I have been blessed to be a fellow ever since. I'm also the founder and CEO of a company named Odulair, which you are going to learn about. So, you know, when I got this slide from Hillary, I really fell in love with change the world, start with yours. I think that is an absolutely fabulous tagline. And when I started writing this presentation, I started thinking, change the world, start with yours. Well, wow, my world is the whole world. And what do I do to change it? So what I want to share with you in the next hour and a half is this is my world, and this is the little piece of what I do to help change that world. So welcome to Changing the World, One Mobile Clinic at a Time. Let me tell you a little bit about myself to start off and set the scene. So I was born in Augusta, Georgia, a place that you've probably never heard of unless you happen to be a golf fan. This happens to be the Augusta National Golf Course, where a pretty famous golf tournament called the Masters happens there every year. And that's really about the only reason you would have ever heard of Augusta, Georgia. It also, though, happens to be the home of Medical College of Georgia. And I graduated from Medical College of Georgia. Actually, I graduated twice. The first time in 1983. Yes, I'm that old. And the second time in 1985. In 83, I graduated with a degree in nuclear medicine. And in 1985, I graduated with a degree in ultrasound. And, you know, it's a school that I'm always proud to have attended because it's one of the oldest medical schools in the United States. Might not be the most famous, but I actually graduated in 1983 on the 150th anniversary of the school. And this gentleman that you see here in his, you know, as I like to joke with one of my dissertation committee members, Stephen Murphy Shigematsu, who has that same color, as I joke, pink robe. I think we all in higher ed know that that means that he graduated from Harvard. So this gentleman who was the president of the school, though handing me my certificate there, this was the last activity that he did at MCG. Before going on to be the Surgeon General of the United States. So it was a very proud moment for our school and a very proud moment for me. Now, after I graduated, I actually started working in a mobile clinic. My first job straight out of school, you see a map here of South Carolina and Georgia, and right smack dab in the middle, you see Augusta. Augusta is right on the state line between Georgia and South Carolina, and you probably down a little bit to the lower right, you see Savannah. Well, I actually had a van, and I had nuclear medicine and ultrasound equipment, and I serviced 4 very rural hospitals, all in South Carolina. You can see on the upper left there, welcome to Allendale. The county that where Allendale is located is actually always the poorest county in the state of South Carolina. Then also on the left there, you see the downtown of Hampton, South Carolina. You can see the size of the towns that I'm talking about. Over on the upper right, you see Ridgeland, South Carolina. You'll, by the way, note, none of these places are actually on that map I'm showing you. That's how small they are. And then down on the lower right on the coast, you see Beaufort, South Carolina. So my typical week would start, I would start off in Augusta on Monday morning, load up all my equipment, get in the van, drive to Allendale, pull all of the equipment out of the van, go into a very small hospital, and do all the patients in that hospital, load it back up in the van, drive 15 miles to Hampton, do all the patients in their hospital, load it back in the van, drive another hour down to Beaufort, unload, do all the work in their hospital, load back up. On Tuesday, I would go first to Ridgeland in the morning and then come back to Beaufort. Wednesday, I would start off in Beaufort, work my way back up, and that was my life. I literally lived in 2 locations. On the weekends, I was always in Augusta, and during the week, I was always in Beaufort. And I did this for a period of 3 years, working in very, very rural communities and doing all of my work out of a mobile medical clinic. Now, after that, after 3 years of doing that, one day I got a call on the phone from a company named AcuSign. You see a piece of ultrasound equipment there. They called and recruited me to come to work for them. They were a very small company at the time, not quite a startup, but had just put out their first piece of equipment. I had had the luxury of seeing the equipment while I was doing some work for someone else. But it was amazing equipment. They offered me a less than 50% of what I was making at my mobile clinic job, because in the mobile clinic job, everything is up to you. So if you hustle, you can actually make a lot of money. And, you know, I thought long and hard about it, and I realized that this equipment was the equipment of the future, and that if I went to work for that company, my life would change. And it did. So I took the job. I will tell you that back in, this was in 1987, back in 1987, as a tech working in a mobile clinic, I made $80,000, which was a ton of money back then, and they offered me $32,000 to take the job. Couldn't get them a penny higher. And again, I thought about it and I said, you know what, I'm going to do it because I believe I can really learn something important at this company. So I did take the job, and I will say it was probably the smartest decision of my entire life. I spent 11 years at AcuSign. I was there from the very beginning of 1987 through the end of 1997. And at that point, I went to work for a company that you've probably all heard of, Siemens. At the time, Siemens had about 500,000 employees in 190 countries, and Siemens was the largest company in the world. This was, of course, you know, before the advent of the mega countries, mega companies like Google. So I moved to Seattle and worked for Siemens in Seattle. I would work 2 weeks in Seattle and 2 weeks in Germany, back and forth. I worked in the ultrasound division, but I was actually brought into the company to introduce the company to the cardiac marketplace, which was one of my specialties. So I had the benefit of working on the world's first cardiac CT, the world's first cardiac MRI, and a lot of other world's first products, just like I had when I was at AcuSign as well. Spent 3 years there and then moved to Santa Barbara. That's what got me to Santa Barbara. I came to work here for a company named Computer Motion, which merged with another company named Intuitive Surgical. And we produced surgical robotic systems. So that giant thing that you see right there is a physician-guided robot for doing surgery. We specialized in cardiac surgery and general surgery at Computer Motion and Intuitive Surgical. Then next I went for a little spinoff named CBeyond that was a spinoff of the neurosurgery department, the Neurosciences Institute at Stanford. And we did image-guided surgery, which is what you see there. And we specialized in neurology, brain surgery, which is what you're seeing there, and spinal surgery. So that was my next step after my mobile clinic job. And, you know, time passed. About 25 years of time passed. And after 9/11, it was very difficult to travel immediately thereafter. And I was living in Santa Barbara and working in Palo Alto, so up in Silicon Valley. I decided that I needed to do something in Santa Barbara. So myself and a partner founded a company named Advanced Mobile Hospital Systems. And we built mobile surgery units. So that's what you see a picture of here. This is a semi-trailer that, as it's driving down the road, looks very similar to any semi-trailer you'd see. but it pops out on both sides and makes a facility that's about 1,000 square feet and can be fully licensed as an ambulatory surgery center. So this was the first unit that we ever built. We actually built two of them that were mirror images of one another, and they went to Stony Brook University Medical Center, which is on Long Island in New York. And they used these units for about 7 years while they were doing some renovation on their hospital. And so I started this company with a partner in 2003. And along the way, this place named Fielding popped up on my radar. And I entered into the HOD program at Fielding. And you know, there, you know, we all talk about the Fielding experience. So there's what we learn, and then there's what we experience when we are a Fielding student and meet other Fielding students. And, you know, I had the benefit of going through the program and working with people from all over the world. Something, you know, I've worked all over the world my whole life, ever since the beginning at Accuson. I've worked in over 50 countries. But I remember at graduation at Fielding, I was in a pretty small graduating class. We had about, I think there were 13 or 14 of us in our graduating class. And you know, you don't know all the people that graduate with you because you didn't necessarily go through school with them. But I remember sitting there, and you know, you all know how the graduation works. So your chair stands up and your chair speaks about you, and then you stand up. I don't even remember who this person was. I wish I knew. And I don't even remember who the chair was. But I remember one of the men who graduated when I did, his chair talked about what he does in the world. And when he finished Fielding, he worked for the UN. When he finished Fielding, his job was to figure out how to feed 400,000 refugees in Ethiopia. And that's what he spoke about. And I was so moved by his chair's, you know, discussion of him and what he was going to do, that I remember sitting there listening and thinking, I want to do that. So I actually changed what I do for a living because of that. So I went back to my partner in Amos and said, you know what, I'm not that interested in just building these $3 million surgical units that only very, you know, very large hospitals in the US can afford to buy or afford to use. I want to build a full product line, and I want to have everything you can imagine. And I want to be able to sell to developing countries and sell all over the world. My partner wasn't interested in that, so I said, okay, that's fine. I'll sell you my half of my company and I'll open another one. So when I made that look back, I made that decision, that's what I was going to do. I was going to walk away from a very successful company here. It's funny, I didn't think about this before, but as I say this now, I see a theme. I was going to walk away from Amos and I was going to start my own company. And I started my own company, and the name of the company is Odulair. The name comes from a French word. You know, one of the hardest things to do today is name a company because you have to get the URL. So people always ask, where in the world did you get the name? If you put an M on the front and an E on the back, then you have the French word modulaire, which is their word for modular. And the concept initially was that if you created, we'll call it a convoy, or if you created a group of mobile clinics of different types, you took them all out together in a convoy and did what we call circling the wagons, where you all put them together, you could actually have a modular hospital and have everything you would need in a hospital. So even way back when we came up with the tagline, healthcare where you need it, because that is absolutely what we deliver at Odulair. So I founded Odulair in 2008. While I was still at Fielding, I didn't really do much with it until about 2011 after I graduated. I started working on R&D, pulling everything together on what we were going to offer to the world, and then was ready to go. So you might ask yourself, well, what in the world is a mobile clinic? Like, what is this thing she did work in? So you might see something like this driving around and think, oh, that's what a mobile clinic is. Or you might see something like this and think, oh, well, maybe that's a mobile clinic. Or something like this. Or even something as small as like a Sprinter van and think that's what a mobile clinic is. And you're right, it can be any of those things. We actually, when with companies, you usually have something called an elevator pitch, which is what you would tell someone if you met them in an elevator and, you know, you've got to explain what you, they go, oh, what do you do? And you need to explain it before you get to the 10th floor. So our elevator pitch, which describes what Odulair does, is we believe that access to healthcare is a basic human right. Therefore, anything you would see in a doctor's office or a hospital, we put in a truck, a trailer, a bus, or a shipping container so that those people who do not have access to healthcare now can. And that pretty much says it all. That is what we do. So if you're wondering what is inside a mobile clinic, there are many, many, many types of mobile clinics. Remember, anything that you'd see in a doctor's office or a hospital. So this is a picture of the interior of a primary care clinic. This clinic can be used for primary care, cardiology, or for women's health. Looks amazingly like a doctor's office, doesn't it? Probably a little bigger than your doctor's office, actually. This is a dental mobile clinic. And this, of course, is where I started. This is an ambulatory surgery center. So that is what the inside of that trailer that you saw a minute ago, that's what the interior of that trailer actually looks like. So those are the mobile clinics. So we actually build and ship mobile clinics all over the world. And I'm going to start off by showing you a little video. Now, we did a little test on the sound a minute ago, and it's not fabulous because you're going to have to hear the sound coming out of my computer. So you might want to turn up your speakers and just kind of play with it a little bit so it doesn't get too distorted, because I've got it pretty loud here. But here is an example of what some of our clients do with our mobile clinics. The ones that you're seeing here in this picture, this is a partial shipment that was going to Ghana, West Africa. And you're going to see the use of those now.
What exactly are you going into your facilities today?
Today there are about 300 children at this orphanage, and they have all already been pre-screened, so they've had all of their vital signs taken, they've had their patient history taken, and now they are going for medicines here just behind you, and they're also going to have their eyes checked, have their teeth checked, and then also have a general physical exam.
My general assessment is that the program is running very smoothly, and it's a wonderful program. You can see it by the this program is already having on the health of Ghanaian children and the adult population at large. We're very happy to be working with Odulair. We think they have fantastic, fantastic machinery, and we're pretty happy to roll it out in South Africa.
We could use this, because this has three monkeys. We could use this for registration, and then we could use that one smaller for screening. So as they finish here, as they register here, then they move their screening, and then screening sends them to the unit.
And
studies, we talk a lot about throughput and patient throughput. And when we say patient throughput, we mean you do well if you see four patients in an hour. In rural Africa, throughput is we on average see about 1,500 patients in the course of about 6 hours.
Odulair has come on board to partner our government to provide us with this kind of mobile clinics to undertake such good project.
We'll be going out on a national outreach program. You know, it's been successful right now with the children. Tomorrow will be the public. And it is something that we are going to sustain. I mean, as our contribution to providing the people of this country good quality healthcare. Thank you.
So I get to say something here that I don't usually get to. I don't usually get to say when I'm in a presentation. But you did see the gentleman at the beginning of the video, and you know, because fielding is so much about social justice, I do get to say yes. That was the grandson of Nelson and Winnie Mandela. I personally did not get the opportunity to work with Nelson Mandela. I was actually supposed to have a meeting with him the month after he passed away. So I regret that I didn't, but working with his foundation was an absolutely wonderful experience. He was all about helping children, and ran a wonderful foundation, and his grandson is following in his footsteps in doing that. So this is, these are the clinics that we delivered to the Ministry of Health in Ghana, West Africa. This is their parliament. They were actually launched at parliament. They have 18 of our clinics. They have 10 biometric testing vans, and they have 8 of those large trucks. When we initially delivered them, we went over, we taught them how to use all the equipment, and then a couple of months later, they actually brought us back and said, teach us how to create a nationwide mobile health program. So we did. That's where we basically cut our teeth in developing very, very large scale programs. And you just saw a video of the launch of that program. You saw that at two different places. The first one was Aga Sutherland Children's Park. That's where you saw all the children. And that is in Accra, Ghana, which is the capital. And the second place that you saw, Agbogbloshie, that's also in the outskirts of Accra. And that is most definitely is the saddest place that I've ever been in my life. That's a place where countries that collect things like old cell phones, old computers, etc., and send them, quote, donations to other countries, but they don't work. They arrive in literally container loads on ships. And at Agbogbloshie, that is it's an area where scrap dealers work. And you saw the little children going around and you saw the fires. They literally take the internals, guts of a computer, and they burn them out in the open air in order to pull out the precious metals and retrieve the precious metals. As you saw there, it has been written about many times as being the most toxic place on the planet. So it was quite an experience to actually launch the program for the public at Agbogbloshie. Now, as you can imagine, it would be very difficult to do something. It would be very difficult to do something like that without the support of the government. So we were very blessed to have, this is Madam Shirley Ayete. She was not the Minister of Health at the time that they ordered the clinics, but at the time they were delivered, she was the Minister of Health and fully supportive of the program. These three women are very interesting. So I'd like to tell you a little bit about them. So these three women are leaders in their community. They are called Queen Mothers. And each one is a Queen Mother of a different community. And they were selected by their community based on the respect they garner in the community. And I remember when I met the first Queen Mother that I met, you know, that they generally come off as very unassuming and a little bit shy and timid. And I remember asking, well, what's the role of the Queen Mother? You know, what do you do in the community? And she said, well, you know, we don't do much. We, you know, if someone is having marital problems, they come to us. Or if a woman is having some kind of female problems, they'll come and talk to us. And I said, okay, is that it? Is there anything else you do? And she said, oh yeah, we picked the chief. And I found that so humorous that she said it so nonchalantly, oh, we picked the chief. So every community has a chief, and the queen, when a chief dies, a queen mother will pick three candidates to be the next chief. She picks those three candidates based on that person's respect in the community, their value of being of service to the community, and their charisma. Will the community follow them? I thought those were really interesting, the three criteria to being selected. So they will pick three people who could be the chief, give those three names to the elders. There are typically about 10 to 15 elders in most fairly large communities. And then the elders will choose one of the three. Now, they don't choose one of the three and announce, yes, this is who we chose. They choose, then they come back to the Queen Mother and say, this is who we chose. And she has veto power. So if she has decided she didn't want that person, then her response is, okay, go choose again. And she can literally get it all the way down to the point where she literally not only picks the three candidates, but she picks the actual chief of the community. And in case you're wondering, a queen mother is always female. A chief could be male or female. So there are masculine and feminine chiefs of the community. And if you're wondering, if you see that young boy who's kind of peeping out, he's in the yellow and blue shirt, and he's kind of peeping out from the woman in the middle, the queen mother in the middle. If you're kind of wondering what he is doing, he is actually, you see something, it looks like he's holding a broomstick. He's actually holding a very large, very intricate umbrella that he will walk around all day to keep these gorgeous three ladies in the shade so that they don't have to endure the hot sun. So there are some serious benefits to being the Queen Mother. Also to have a program like this work, you do have to have the higher levels of the government who buy into the program. And we're very lucky in Ghana. This is John Mahama, who was the president of the country. And you see the clinic looks a little bit different behind us. It has a different wrap on it. He actually believed in mobile healthcare so much that he relaunched the clinics after a couple of years and brought us back to do a whole new program, which I will show you.
The services will cover communities in 43 districts. Under Phase 1, they include 6 districts each in the Western and Volta regions, 3 each in the Eastern, Greater Accra, Upper Nahapu, and Ashanti, 5 in the Northern, and 4 each in the Upper West and Upper East regions. The President also inaugurated 8 vehicles to be used for the program. He said government has so far spent $1 billion on all health facilities.
This is Phase 1 of the outreach. We are commissioning 8 vans today for that outreach, and we are expecting more mobile vans. And as more mobile vans come, we will expand the scope of the medical outreach. Medical outreach van will go to these districts and provide health care to them. In the last 5 years, we have made the largest investment in health care in the history of this country. And what does it take to give quality health care to a people? What does it take to invest in health care? It must be accessible. And when it's accessible, it means that healthcare facilities must be close to the people. We have spent more than $1 billion on health facilities in this country, and we're seeing the results of it. It has led to the improvement of the health status of Ghanaians.
Did you hear him say full speed ahead? He said full speed ahead.
Okay, as you can see, President Mahama is a bit of a rock star. they all go crazy when he comes around. He's a very, very beloved president. I have to step aside for a second and take this opportunity to tell you before I see this picture all over a Fielding webpage tomorrow saying that I'm with cultural appropriation. I would like to tell you, as you can see, I have on a native Ghanaian dress. When I first went there, I absolutely fell in love with their outfits, their materials, the colors. I mean, they're so beautiful. They're so bright and beautiful. So when I go there, I actually have a woman that I met who makes clothes for me. And before we went to this event, I asked Dr. Gebe, who you're going to see in a couple of minutes, I asked Dr. Gebe, what should I wear? Should I wear what I wear at home, or should I wear one of my Ghanaian dresses? And I'll never forget, you know, he said, is it a nice dress? He wanted to know if it truly was a Ghanaian dress or if it was just my interpretation of a Ghanaian dress. I said, yeah, it is a nice dress. And with that, I decided, and he said, yeah, then you should wear it. So that is what I have on here. I have on traditional Ghanaian dress, and everyone from President Mahama to Dr. Gebe to the chief and everyone, the minister, everyone down, basically said, thank you so much for honoring us by wearing our traditional dress. So it was a great experience. And the guy that you saw at the end of the video that had on the very, very colorful robe, he's actually the chief of this particular area. And if you're curious of the chief's role, the chief is obviously the ruler of the community, and everyone goes to the chief, and the chief presides over the elders. But the chief also owns all the land. So no one other than a chief can own land there. So if let's say that, you know, Marriott wants to come in and build a hotel, they have to go and negotiate to lease the land from the chief. They're not allowed to own the land. So it is, chiefs are very revered. And for our work in Ghana, the program was actually awarded the OPIC Impact Award. If you're not familiar with OPIC, OPIC, OPIC is the Overseas Private Investment Corporation. It sounds like an outside entity. It's actually a piece of the U.S. government. It's the piece of the U.S. government that funds foreign investment into foreign countries for many different reasons. Healthcare is one of them. So our clinics actually won the OPIC Impact Award, and then you can see one of the quotes there. And I told you Dr. Gebe asked me, is it a nice dress? This is Dr. Gebe right here, the gentleman who is holding my hands and saying thank you. And I have this picture here because years later, Dr. Gebe came back to us and said, we need your help. This time when he came back and said, we need your help, He needed something very different. He needed something like this. And he needed this because the Ebola outbreak had started, and the Ebola outbreak was going in three neighboring countries. And they realized that they did not have anything to protect them from Ebola entering into Ghana. So he reached out to us and said, can you create some type of patient isolation unit that will keep Ebola out of our country? So with that, I actually reached out. I found an email on the web, and I reached out to Dr. David Nabarro, who was the UN Special Envoy on Ebola. Talked to him, asked him if he could teach me everything he knew about Ebola and everything we needed to know to isolate a patient. He then referred me over to Dr. Bruce Allward, who is the Assistant Director General for the World Health Organization. And he gave me a lot of information and said, you know, you really need to talk to Ian. And Dr. Ian Norton is an Australian emergency medicine physician who is the chief of medical teams for the WHO. And I had many, many, many conversations with these three men, many conversations with Ian while he, you know, was on his cell phone moving in and about Monrovia, Liberia, moving from, you know, patient area to patient area, trying to keep the medical teams, trying to keep the medical team safe. And I think, you know, this was happening long before any of us in the United States were really aware that there was such a large Ebola crisis. We actually started working on this project in December, and I think the first time we really heard it on the news was the following in the US was the following March. So we did actually develop an Ebola isolation unit. We developed one that could be used in tents. Tents were important because tents are rapidly deployable, meaning you wouldn't do it in a truck or a trailer, because if you had to build it in the US and ship it overseas, it would take 4 to 6 weeks to get there. Whereas a tent, you can fold up and put on a plane and get it there quickly. And during the Ebola crisis, speed was absolutely paramount. So the work that we did in this area actually got us mentioned. There was an article written about our product in The Economist in the Technology Quarterly about the Ebola product, that the Ebola patient isolation unit that we created. And at the end, Dr. Nabarro said, you know, you ought to patent this. No one's ever done anything like it. So these three gentlemen were just absolutely you know, as helpful as they possibly could be, and kind enough to share their information with us. So we did become experts on patient containment and on infectious disease containment, and we now have three patents on infectious disease containment systems, which, as you can imagine, came in handy recently. with COVID. So we have been working in the COVID arena since February of 2020. So literally when the first cases were talked about in China, we were pulled into the fray then. And we've been shipping COVID mobile testing labs from one side of the country. This is Riverside, California, to New York City. So we've been shipping them everywhere. And these are the types of units where the COVID testing is taking place. You know, there are really two kinds of COVID testing. There's point of care testing, and then there's PCR testing, and they have to be done in completely different environments. So this unit you see right here, which is at Elmhurst Hospital in New York City, just so you know, Elmhurst was the first, that hospital was the first hotspot in New York City. They, at one point, they had seen more COVID cases than any other hospital in the United States. And They actually, we parked this unit right outside their main entrance to their hospital. And anyone who's going to enter into the hospital walks through this unit before they get in. They walk through, they go into an ante room in the center. They go up these stairs and into a room. They have their nasal swab, and then they either get a point of care test on one side of the unit or a PCR test on the other side, and then they have to wait on the results before they are allowed to go into the hospital. So I'm going to show you what the inside of this unit looks like. It has three rooms. You enter into, each one of the three rooms is an ISO 7 room. This meets all the CDC requirements. So you can walk in one side and out the other side, just like you can see there. They walk into the ante room, which is this room, through that door you see. There's a scrub sink, there's a table where supplies are kept right here, and this is where they have their nasal swab. Then they walk straight across and out. That swab is passed through the big silver thing with the door there you see, which is a HEPA pass-through box. For PCR testing, it goes into this room. Those are ISO 5 biological safety cabinets and a large vaccine fridge. So the PCR testing is done in that room. The point of care testing room is done in this room. These are laminar flow hoods. The air in this entire unit is very, very clean. This is why it's safe for anyone to work in there. So literally in this entire trailer, every molecule of air is completely ejected and replaced literally every minute. So in other words, when you're inside this lab, it basically sounds like you're in a wind tunnel. There's a lot of air moving and a lot of air moving very, very quickly. But that's what has to be done to keep the staff safe so that they don't get COVID. We've also been pretty integral in working in disaster response. So you probably remember about some very, very large hurricanes. So back on September the 6th in 2017, Hurricane Irma hit the U.S. Virgin Islands and hit Puerto Rico at a Cat 5 rating, which is 185 miles an hour. At the time this happened, that was the fastest wind speed of a direct hit of a hurricane at the time. Now, this was very significant. This did a tremendous amount of damage. However, you look at that date, 9/6/17, up there in the upper left corner. Well, exactly 2 weeks to the day later, they were hit by Hurricane Maria. Again, a direct hit at 175 miles an hour. So this is what it looked like. And we were brought in later to help with dialysis patients. This was the state of all of these islands. Here you see the waiting room at the John F. Louis Hospital on St. Croix in the U.S. Virgin Islands. All of these patients that you see right here are dialysis patients. If you don't know much about dialysis, once a patient is put on dialysis, they will stay on dialysis until they either receive a kidney transplant or until they pass away. Sadly, that's why doctors wait such a long time before they actually put a patient on dialysis. When you're on dialysis, you have treatments or dialysis treatments three times a week, typically every other day. So you may be on a Monday, Wednesday, Friday schedule, or you may be on a Tuesday, Thursday, Saturday schedule. but you're going to have to have dialysis every other day in order to filter out the toxins from your blood so that you will not, your decreased renal function is not going to cause you to increase those toxins, which is life-threatening. So these people, the hospital knew, and FEMA knew this hurricane was going to hit. They may not have power. Without power, you can't do dialysis. So these people went in one day for their dialysis treatment, knowing the hurricane is coming, but not knowing exactly when it's going to hit. And they were told, you're not going back home. We're putting you on a plane and we're shipping you to Atlanta. So they were literally moved from the Virgin Islands to Atlanta by the military so that they could continue their dialysis treatments. They stayed in Atlanta a year and a half at the cost of about $3.5 million per month to the U.S. government. There were 67 patients who did this. And then we were asked to bring in a mobile dialysis unit. In fact, we were asked to bring in two mobile dialysis units. Now, I remember going down to St. Croix for the first time in January, looking at this parking lot, and they said, oh, when the units get here, you'll have everything you need. You'll have power, you'll have water, you'll have sewer, you'll just have to back them in, hook them up, and that's it. Well, you know, we came back. there was a lot of back and forth. We finally got ourselves and the units to the island in September. And when I arrived, it looked just like the same parking lot I saw in January. Nothing had been done. I found out later that FEMA had been trying to accomplish this and getting the water, power, and sewer in for a year and a half and hadn't been able to do it. So U.S. Department of Health and Human Services then came back and said, hey, Anita, you think you could put in the water, power, and sewer? At that point, you know, I said, wow, we've never done that before, but hey, why not? We can definitely try. So, you know, I showed up on the island on September the 4th with one small suitcase, and I came home November 4th, 9 weeks later. But in that 9 weeks, we did actually get the two units set up. We had capacity to treat 72 patients for dialysis, and this is a group photo of the leadership of the hospital, local leadership of FEMA that was deployed to St. Croix as well, and leadership from HHS for getting it done. And this is our very first patient. So this was a huge milestone, not just for them, but for us, because this was the first time in history that a mobile dialysis unit had actually been licensed and certified for use and for Medicare reimbursement by the Center for Medicare and Medicaid Services. In this picture here, Mr. Finnessy there, it was our very first patient during our inspection. On the right, you see Colette White, who is the dialysis nurse in charge of the department. In the middle, you see Captain Nancy Miller. Captain Miller actually is part of the U.S. Public Health Service and is the branch chief for this region for CMS, Center for Medicare and Medicare Services, and then, of course, me. So this was a great day for us. We had been looking forward to this for a long time, and these patients were absolutely thrilled to come home after being basically stranded in Atlanta for 18 months. Now, while that was happening, at the same time in Puerto Rico, there had been just over 3,000 deaths. And there's a small island off the east coast of Puerto Rico named Vieques. And there were 13 patients on Viakis that had no access to dialysis. And if you, you know, these are not miniature horses, if you are wondering, that is how deep the flooding was on Viakis. Viakis was very, very hard hit, probably harder hit actually than the main island of Puerto Rico. There, this was their hospital, and the hospital was completely flooded and condemned and had to be shut down. So they built a very small temporary hospital and asked us to bring in dialysis. This lady to the left here is Dora Beringer, and Dora is actually the CEO of the hospital. And here you see her having a conversation with the gentleman in the right with the FEMA shirt on, that's Brock Long. Brock Long, at the time, was the head of FEMA. And their dialysis patients were in a different situation. They weren't evacuated. They weren't evacuated to Atlanta. They actually had to take a plane, this little small plane you see here, they had to take a plane to the mainland three times a week to have their dialysis treatments. So the Secretary of Health in Puerto Rico reached out to us and asked if we could bring them a mobile dialysis unit also, just like on St. Croix. Here you see a picture of the, ours is the unit in the middle on a very small government ferry crossing from the mainland over to Viakis. And then here we are delivering it to Viakis. And the gentleman on the left you see here is the Secretary of Health. Or he was at the time, he's since retired. He was at the time the Secretary of Health. This is Rafael Rodriguez Mercado. He actually is a practicing neurosurgeon and just a wonderful man. And whenever we had everything up and running, he came over to personally meet with all of their dialysis patients. He was just so excited that they could finally stay home. So that was a wonderful experience as well. Now I'm going to shift gears. And another thing that we support are school-based programs. So this is a trailer. We've actually built the world's largest mobile dental clinic twice. We built one and then we built one even bigger. And, you know, it's interesting because one can claim the rights for the largest because of the physical square footage of the unit, and the other one can claim the rights to the largest for the number of chairs that are in the unit. So this unit is physically the largest, but it has 6 chairs. The other one is physically a little bit smaller, but has 8 chairs. This unit is owned by Queens Care, which is a faith-based organization down in Los Angeles, and they provide full dental care to underserved populations of students in downtown Los Angeles, like literally right in the middle of town. They will pull this unit into a schoolyard. It will sit there, it could be 2 months, it could be 3 months, and they will provide dental care to every student in that entire school. The Queens Care is the organization that runs the program, and University of Southern California Dental School actually performs the dentistry and the hygiene work that happens inside the unit. And speaking of USC, they have the other world's largest mobile dental clinic. Their unit is a little smaller, but their unit has 8 chairs. It is also a school-based program. I love bragging about them because they are the oldest mobile dental program that we know of in the world. They have been running this program more than 50 years. They literally started by taking portable equipment, putting in the trunks of their cars. and taking it places. And they actually operate on the north end. They go a little bit further north than Fresno, California, and they go almost down to San Diego. So they cover a range of almost 500 miles north to south. They have our very large unit, and then they have three smaller units. They will go into a school parking lot. They will stay there for 2 weeks, and they will do full comprehensive dentistry on about 125 students while they are there. The school actually selects the students based upon need, and they will do everything. Literally, if a student needs a root canal, they will do a root canal in the mobile clinic. And the program is run by Dr. Santosh Sundarasan, and I'm gonna have a little video of him here. You'll be able to see the inside of the clinic also.
It's got 8 demo chairs, so it's basically 2 trailers in one, and that was the goal. And this is completely integrated for digital use. It's got 16 data ports inside this trailer. Every chair has a data port and 8 other data ports. So 8 chairs, 8 data ports, and 8 other data ports in and around that trailer, aligning this way. So it gives a technology where we can connect, we can be integrated not only within but also from on the web. We designed it where we have space to perform sterilizations. As I said, we have a whole separate trailer to do sterilizations. But we put the provision where, if needed, we can put sterilizers in the trailer itself and do as a standalone unit, where we don't have to rely on a separate trailer to do sterilizations. The other advantage is the ease of setup and use. We can literally park it, expand the hours, remove the budgies and the cables to hold those chairs together and start working. It doesn't have any hoses, it doesn't have any cables like electricity and anything else. It has its own generator for power, it's got its own water tank, so no hoses are needed, and its capacity is almost 80 gallons on that. It's got its own compressor and a vacuum, it's self-leveling vehicles, and it's a standalone vehicle which is self-contained.
As you can tell, I love bragging about our customers. They do amazing work, and we're very blessed to be able to help them. The last clinic that I'll show you here is one that I'm really proud of, because I've been interested in solar power and solar powered mobile clinics since we started working in Africa, because in many cases, a group, a nonprofit, it can actually be fairly easy for them to get the money to buy a mobile clinic, but it's not easy for them to get the money to run the operations year after year after year. You know, that's just not as sexy as getting a new mobile clinic. So I've always felt that solar power would be something that could tremendously reduce the operating costs for mobile clinics. And this is a clinic that we delivered to Clemson University. We delivered this clinic in 2015. This clinic, since 2015, so for just over 5 years, this clinic has literally run on the sun. You'll see a little bit more about it and what's on the inside. And this clinic goes all over the state. If you don't know anything about Clemson University, the Clemson Tigers, they're all about branding for the Clemson Tigers, in case you're wondering. So this clinic creates quite a stir when people see it in and amongst other clinics, because it doesn't look like any medical clinic they've ever seen. It's unique in two ways. One is the solar power. The other one is it's what we call a flex clinic, because the walls on the interior are movable. So you can reconfigure it to be one large room for educational purposes, or it can be 3 individual exam rooms plus a lab and a bathroom if you're out seeing patients. And it is actually a Ford F650 4x4. So they take this thing out in farm fields. They take it all over the place. And they, inside the clinic, they specialize in women's health. They treat a lot of migrant farm workers inside this clinic doing women's health and also doing nutritional counseling to help people improve their diets. And here is a little video so you can see the inside of this clinic as well.
This awesome day is very special to be on the Clemson University campus and be a part of the unveiling of the new Joseph Sullivan Mobile Clinic.
We are in our 26th year of clinic outreach, and we have just completed a 2-year process of designing and building a concept mobile clinic like no other one in the world.
We were actually contacted by Dr. Paula Watt, who is director of the Joseph F. Sullivan Center here at Clemson. And she was looking for something different. She had had 2 mobile clinics in the past, but now she needed something different that would get her in and out of farm fields so that she could serve underserved populations.
The need is greater now than probably it ever has been, is to have the opportunity to go out into the rural parts of South Carolina, from the Appalachian Mountains to the foothills, to the Midlands, to the coast.
Senator Alexander had a vision for us to work specifically with our academic partner at NUSC, the Hollings Cancer Center. They have a mobile program also. So we were challenged to find a way to work statewide, and that is what we are doing.
This is the world's first 100% solar-powered mobile clinic. It has no generator. It needs no generator. It literally operates with the sun and lithium-ion battery packs. A typical lithium-ion battery will last 10 years. So between now and then, it's completely maintenance free. This is the first, and this is the future of mobile clinics, and we're very proud to be a part of that future.
And to have the opportunity to have a unit that has been designed for the actual need of being a mobile clinic is critical from that standpoint.
So, in closing, how can we make these things happen? You know, we run our company based on some very strict core values. We run our company in a way that every person that we hire has to meet a core values test before they get any further. I don't care if they're the best in the world at what they do. They don't come to work for us if they don't meet our core values. And these are our core values. We identify and solve problems. We deliver positive market disruptions. We are the choice of innovators. We used to say we are the innovators, and we changed that because there is a Mobile Clinic Innovation Award. It's been given out 3 times, and the lady that you saw just a second ago, Dr. Paula Watt, who is a nurse PhD, and Dr. Santosh Sundarasan, who is the dentist, they have both won. So 2 out of 3 times that the awards have been given for mobile clinic innovation, they've been given to our clients. We know simple is better than complex, fast is better than slow, and smart is better than dumb. We play to win. And we play to win, and our results define who we are. We create our own destiny, and above all else, we make yes possible. So that is who I am as a person. That is who we are as a company. And that is how we accomplish the things that we do. So with that, I would like to say thank you very much. And if anyone has any questions, I think we have a couple of minutes. So Charles, I see you're there. I'm going to ask you how we want to take questions. Oops, unmute. One second. I'm going to do that.
Okay, there we go.
I'll unmute you.
Thank you very much. Well, listen, I want to speak for, I think, everyone who has been attending your session, that this is just a stunning presentation, and we're almost speechless, but I'm sure not speechless. I'm sure people have some questions. I do want to say again, and I'm glad you reminded me, you were in the inaugural group of ISI fellows, and I think that's completely appropriate because your innovation in this world of mobile health clinics is truly stunning. So with that, I think we'll just turn it over to, let's see, the host can unmute people so that they can unmute themselves and let people ask you questions, Anita. I have to drop off to get to another meeting in just a few minutes, so I'll be here, but then our session hosts will close things out and manage any other Q&A issues. So on behalf of the audience, how about a round of applause for Dr. Anita Chambers?
Thank you. Mm-hmm.
Go ahead, folks, with your questions.
Yeah, and you should be able to get on camera. That would be great to see some of your faces. I know some names on here. I'd love to take some questions. Anita, I'm just overwhelmed and floored by this outstanding, amazing work that you've done. I don't even know where to start with questions. I just want to keep hearing more and more and more. And just, my goodness, the good work that you are doing in the world is just so impressive. And thank you for the work that you're doing. I appreciate it.
Thank you.
It looks like there's a couple
people. Thanks for the support from ISI.
And if anybody'd like to come on camera, if you have any questions, we would love to, we have a little bit more time here. While we're waiting, Anita, what are you, the theme for this conference is global leading and learning in the next decade. And I'm wondering your thoughts about your work now and what it might look like in the future, or what you see coming up on the horizon that would be beneficial. You know, COVID in this last year and the pandemic, you were uniquely set up to meet the needs of people immediately in a way that I don't think anybody could have expected. So this is why I was so excited to hear your presentation today. But we can't foresee the future, but I'm just curious if you have any thoughts.
You know, that's a great question, Hillary. It is interesting because literally everything, with the exception of one clinic that we are building right now, is COVID related. So we saw the same thing that everyone did. People started becoming aware of COVID in maybe March, and started questioning it. People working in hospitals and healthcare facilities in the period of Q2, there was a little bit of stagnate. Well, not a little bit. There was a lot. There was a lot of stagnation. I mean, I described it in my Southern best as everybody was like a deer in the headlights. You know, they didn't know what to do. So they knew they needed to do something. They were concerned, they were worried, but no one made a move. You know, no hospitals, nothing. Everything, I think, in the business world just came to a crashing halt. And then it really didn't pick up again until Q4. But, there was a lot of CARES Act money that went out to nonprofits as well as governments. And literally everything that we are building right this minute is coming from CARES Act money. And we just delivered two units to UCSF that are going to be used in Fresno. That's all COVID related. We have four units going out to LA County in a couple of weeks. That they're going to be used in the inner city of LA County to do COVID testing and to treat the homeless population in LA County. We have two more units that are going to Clemson University. They're going to take them all over the state doing COVID testing and COVID related work. We have another one going to a small community hospital up in Idaho. They're going to do exactly the same thing. And we have another one that went to Casper, Wyoming, to a small nonprofit there that'll all do COVID testing. We have another one. We have a very small biosafety lab type 2, which is a CDC type lab for doing actual COVID testing, the PCR testing, just like the big unit that I showed you. There, it's going to the Wyoming Department of Public Health, and they're going to drive it around every place they have a hotspot within the state. They'll drive the lab to the hotspot and then run tests on site, you know, in shopping centers and things like that. We have a couple of others that have gone out in the past couple of weeks that have gone to various Indian nations. One to a group in Montana called All Nations, which is a combination, I believe they're Lakota, Crow, they're like five different tribes that are there. And then we have another one that's going out to the Crow soon. So literally everything we're building right now is COVID related and for the purpose of helping define who has COVID, either by doing point of care testing or doing PCR testing, or help look for symptoms in possible COVID patients. So that is a shift. And the other thing you ask about, Hillary, you're right. A lot of people are very interested in mobile. Even I was on a conference last night. I'm on the board of directors for the American Mobile Dental Association. And they were talking about a lot of their patients that are asking for mobile dentistry because they don't want to go into the dentist's office. So even patients who can get out and about, you just don't want to go expose yourself to COVID if you don't have to. So any other questions? Yes, Tara, can you, you're muted right now.
Yes. Hi, Anita. How are you?
Hey, how are you?
Yeah, Anita and I are from sort of the similar cohort group way back when. And I always had the great pleasure to be in the room, the first ISI group when you presented. And so I was inspired and stunned then, and I'm doubly so now. So that's about more than 10 years, about 10 years difference or so. But yeah. Hey, Anita, a quick question. You know, I'm from the world of, mental health as it relates to human development. And so, you know, even pre-pandemic, there's, you know, mental health crisis in this country. And, you know, now I live back in my home state of Texas. And so, of course, we have the big cities with lots of care, but then we have massive, you know, geographical area counties that if they have one clinical social worker or, you know, mental health counselor, that's the most they have. And I just wonder, do you get requests or recommendation or, you know, ask about creating such units for to travel about? And
we do actually we've created quite a few behavioral they're typically called behavioral health, not mental health, but we've actually created quite a few. And you're right, it's a crisis right now.
And so it was a crisis before the pandemic, and what I know is right now I'm just, at least for now, and private practice work, and I, you know, can hardly keep up, and that's the truth. And I'm right here in the city with hundreds and hundreds of other therapists, so I'm just imagining the other areas that have almost nothing, even post-pandemic, it's going to be quite a need, high need. So
absolutely, yeah. I'm always when I read the statistics, of the cases, you know, the cases of domestic abuse going up in the pandemic, or the cases of child abuse going up. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's very, very sad. I can understand it, because of course, you know, you probably have it a little easier in Texas. We have it a little easier in Santa Barbara. You know, none of us live in downtown New York in a high-rise building with four people in an 800 square foot apartment. Yeah. I can only imagine what that would be like.
Right.
You know, that we're mm-hmm. all cooped up, but,
right.
but yes, it is.
And who do those requests come from to you when you have created units, mobile units for behavioral health and wellness?
They usually come from public health departments. So sometimes like a county public health department or a state public health department. Occasionally they'll come from a hospital. Mm-hmm. But it's usually from either a public health department or some type of nonprofit.
Gotcha. Okay.
Typically public health, though.
All right, great. So,
and yeah, we just literally build a unit that essentially looks just like your office.
Yeah.
The the difference is that I don't know if they do that in buildings, but because we're in a pretty confined space, then we always situate everything so you are the closest to the door. Mm-hmm. And you know, you have panic buttons and things like that, because
sure.
you know, I don't need to tell you that things can
yeah go and down. And some, you know, sound machines sometimes to, you know, drown out the yeah confidential yeah yeah
it, exactly.
I have to give you a call sometimes to get some pictures of some of those that you've
yeah.
created. So anyway, thanks for the amazing things you're doing in the world. It's great to see you again. Yeah.
Thank you, and great to see you again, Tara. Does anyone else have any questions? I think, how are we doing? We have like 3 minutes, I think, at the most. Going. Okay. All right. Well, if no one else has any questions, I really appreciate your attention. Thank you very much. Thanks for the nice comments. And I thoroughly enjoyed presenting. And I see some names I know and some names I don't. So hopefully next year we can have a winter session and we can see one another in person. That would be a wonderful thing. But between now and then, thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Anita. Hillary had to step out, but I just want to say thanks on behalf of her and the Alumni Relations Office. Thanks so much for sharing your work and spending some time with us. And to everyone who is here, thanks for being a part of the first virtual Alumni Relations Conference, and hope you have a good rest of your day.
Thank you. Do it again. All right. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Thanks, everyone.
Bye, everyone.